Okay, hello friends, welcome to Yogic and Modern Science. Today, I'll be discussing the role of consciousness in order to understand the life, the universe, etc. But today, we'll be discussing this topic, the topic of consciousness from the quantum science point of view. And today, I am with Mr. Chetan Pandey. He's already working he's not working actually, he's studying in MS physics, and he's working in quantum physics and I think string theory. So I would like Chetan to introduce himself firstly, okay, before I put questions to him. Chetan.
Hello, my name is Chetan Pandey and I'm doing my master's in theoretical physics at ICER Pune. And I'm working in the so I'm working with quantum field theories and somewhere to
for my mind. Okay, fine, Chetan. Chetan, firstly, yes, I would like to put one question, very important question. Okay, theoretical physicists for the last 5 or 10 years, they have been studying the role of consciousness or the role of observation, or you can say observer, okay, for that matter. What is the role of observer in studying the quantum state of material? Because there are many scientists, okay, who has said something about this element consciousness or the observer. Okay, let me read you some quotes of some scientist. In 2016, the University of Cambridge in the UK, one of the most respected quantum philosophers, speculated that consciousness might alter the behavior of quantum system in subtle but detectable ways. It means what? It means it is hard to avoid the implication that consciousness and quantum mechanics are somehow linked. And also the physicist Pascal Jordan, who worked with quantum guru Niels Bohr in Copenhagen in the 1920s, put it like this: observation not only disturb what has to be measured, they produce it. In other words, we ourselves produce the result of measurement. So these are, so in this way, you have seen how the scientists are proposing that consciousness has the implications, okay, in the study of, quantum state of the material. Okay, what do you say? Okay, what is your proposition in this regard?
So my understanding is that we still do not understand what consciousness is. So we don't have a very good definition in a precise sense of what consciousness is. So from what I understand, consciousness is thought to be some sort of an emergent phenomena when the biological organisms or the biological system, when it becomes very complex. So it's thought that consciousness probably emerges as some kind of a byproduct when the brain structure is very complex. So this is one, it's a very interesting thing. I'm also very interested in understanding about this consciousness and what it is. And so another thing that is very related to this consciousness is artificial intelligence systems that are being described recently. So recently there has been a lot of progress in artificial intelligence with computer intelligence. So this is also an area which I think is very fascinating, because we'll probably be able to test our theories of consciousness with since we are increasing the amount of complexity in the intelligence of machines. And so probably we'll be able to understand how this emergent behavior of consciousness emerges. About its relation with quantum physics, I'm again, since we do not have a very good definition of what consciousness is, I'm not sure if there is a very precise connection between consciousness and quantum physics. But what I have heard is that, so there is a very respected physicist called Roger Penrose, who got the Nobel Prize in Physics this year for his work in black holes. So he's the proponent of a theory about how there are certain structures in the brain, the quantum effects in which can be probably be linked to consciousness. But I'm not aware about any developments in that field, but there is one thing that is sometimes related to this idea of consciousness in quantum mechanics, and this is related to the collapse of wave function or the measurement ideas in quantum mechanics. So in quantum mechanics, what we have is a system that is described by some kind of a wave function. So a wave function is essentially, so when we have a wave, say a classical wave, an electromagnetic wave, the classical wave that we have, it always has a quantity that can be thought of as waving. And by waving, what we mean is that the amplitude of that quantity changes with time and space. And that is what we describe by having as a wave. For example, in electromagnetic wave or the radio waves that we have, it's the electric and magnetic fields that are the amplitude of which changes with space and time. And these are the physical waves, so we can detect them. For example, if we have a radio antenna in our home. But for a quantum mechanical object, the thing that waves is not usually a physical quantity. So it can be thought of as some kind of a mathematical object, which we call a wave function, because it also obeys a behavior that is similar to classical waves. So, and since this wave function that describes a quantum system has a wave-like behavior, one of the things that it shows is a superposition. So, for example, from classical waves, what we know is that if we have two classical waves and if we add those waves, then the waves simply they add. So, for example, if I have two waves and if both of them are present at a point, then the amplitude of the wave, resultant wave, will be the sum of the amplitudes. So again, for a quantum mechanical wave, the wave function also obeys this kind of a linear superposition principle. And so because of that, we can devise some kind of an experiment where if we have a quantum system, if we have two different states that a quantum system can be in, so we can prepare another state, a new state, which is a superposition of these two, the original states of the quantum system. And so this kind of raises a logical doubt. For example, if we have a system, so two states of the system in quantum mechanics means that there are two different observables that I can associate to the system. For example, it can be two different energy levels of a harmonic oscillator or a hydrogen atom, say. So what I can do in quantum mechanics is I can prepare a state that is a superposition of these two observable states. So for example, I can have a state in my hydrogen atom where the electron is in a superposition of the ground state and the first excited state, say. So now the problem is if this new state that I've prepared, if it is a superposition of these two states, then what exactly is the energy of this state, the superposition state? So this is kind of a question that we usually encounter. And so the answer to this, according to the theory, is that it is a probabilistic answer. So we do not have a precise answer what the energy is, but if it sort of depends upon how I have prepared the state. So for example, if I have prepared the state in an equal proportion of the ground state and the first excited state, I have a chance of observing the energy as the ground state energy for 50% of the time, and the first excited state energy as the other 50% of the time. So I cannot say definitively what the energy of that state would be when I observe it. But what I can answer is that probabilistically, half of the time I will get the ground state energy, half of the time I'll get the first excited state energy. So the problem here is that what exactly happens when you do this observation? So I prepared it in a superposition state. I prepared it as a mixture of the two different observable states. So what exactly happened here when I observed the system? And this is the point where I have seen a lot of places where the idea of consciousness or the observer arises. So what usually happens is that we do not know how to describe how this observation thing takes place. So what we can answer is that once the observation happens, what we know is that after the observation, it will either collapse to the ground state energy, or the wave function will essentially be either the ground state energy or the first excited state. But we do not exactly know how this process happens. And the thing is that in quantum mechanics, this idea doesn't matter how this exactly the collapse happens, because There are a lot of different theories how this collapse might happen, but either ways, it always ends up to be the same. So we'll always get a probabilistic answer that half of the time it has to end up in the ground state, half of the time it has to end up in the first excited state. But again, a more fundamental theory is expected to probably answer this question about how exactly this collapse business occurs. But mathematically, all the different theories are they give the same results, regardless of what like what kind of theories they are. So this is one place where there is a so where the observer plays an important role. People seem to think that the observer might play a very important role in quantum mechanics. And this is related to the superpositions and collapse of wave functions.
Okay. It means what you're saying is the observer plays a role, but you don't know what exactly is happening. Okay. Why there is, you know, a change, okay, in its superposition, okay, in terms of energy. Right. This is what you're saying. And two more things, okay, that you proposed is one thing is you don't know what exactly is consciousness. Okay, you don't know what exactly is consciousness, the definition of consciousness. And the second thing is some, you know, neuroscientists, okay, or people like them, they think that consciousness is some kind of epiphenomenon of some complex system. Okay, if system becomes complex, more and more complex, then consciousness comes into being. Okay, so this is how they think, right? But as far as yogic science is concerned, the spirituality system of India, okay, like the spiritual system of, you know, Vedanta, and there are so many schools of thought, okay. They propose about consciousness is that consciousness is not epiphenomenon. Okay, consciousness is fundamental, right? And because of consciousness, things get more and more complex. Because of consciousness, because internally there is first there comes complexity in the consciousness. As a result, that complexity is expressed in its physical state. Right. So this is the view of yogic science about consciousness. Right. So consciousness is fundamental. Second thing, consciousness is not time and space bound. Means it does not exist in time and space. It is there, okay, but beyond it. It means it does not find its expression in the physical world. That is why we are not able to pinpoint what exactly is consciousness. This is the second thing. Okay, so because, the contemporary scientists, okay, some scientists, they are recognizing the fact that consciousness is fundamental, right? You must have heard some scientists saying all these things, okay. But many of them still, okay, they are not, coming up with this idea that consciousness is fundamental. They are still thinking in terms of consciousness being the epiphenomenon, okay. It is the result of physical state, complex physical state, right? But according to yogic science, it is not so. Okay, so this is where the problem lies. Okay, why we are not able to recognize the importance of observer. But there is something, some link, okay, between consciousness and the physical state of things. Okay, whatever that thing is, okay. So there must be some kind of link, okay. We have not, come up to that stage, okay, where we can say for sure that consciousness has a role to play, right, in order to determine the physical state of the things. Okay, so this is where the difference lies, right? Okay, Chetan. You sir, want to say something?
I have a question here. So this I am not very well, I don't know much about this yogic science. So this consciousness in yogic science that you are talking about, yes, is this related to the actual consciousness that we sort of think as, which is an epiphenomena? So for example, we know that humans or we are conscious beings. So is the consciousness in yogic science that you're talking about related to the same consciousness in
of course
the that of we course. Can
they are very much related. Okay. Suppose I am feeling something. I am feeling that I am talking to you. Okay. And you are also listening on the other side. Okay. So you have also a feeling. Okay. So this feeling, this knowing, okay, and this sensitivity of ours, okay, this sensitivity is a normal consciousness, a physical consciousness, consciousness which is being expressed, okay. Right? So this is the phenomenon, okay, this is something, okay, which is there in the phenomenal world, right? We can pinpoint, okay, what exactly is happening to us, okay, that we are feeling, okay. Suppose if you are feeling pain, okay, then you are feeling it. If I'm feeling happiness, I'm feeling it. Okay, so I can recognize this feeling of happiness or this feeling of pain. But the consciousness which yogic science talks about, okay, is not this. This is the result of that. Okay, that consciousness which is fundamental, okay, it is not expressed, okay, in space and time. But it is the causeless cause of everything in this universe. Okay, so, and it always remains as the causeless cause. It is never expressed itself, but it causes many things. It causes many things to happen. Okay, so this is the result of, or the effect of, the fundamental consciousness, the consciousness that we feel at the physical level. Yes.
Okay, sir. So, one thing is that, so I don't exactly see the connection between, so this, the consciousness that we can sort of feel, or which might be thought of as an emergent property in very complex beings, that is something that I can probably like understand. So for example, it can be thought of as some kind of a property of very intelligent systems. For example, if a computer is very sort of, if it becomes very intelligent, this is also something that should be answered, what it means for a computer to be very intelligent. But suppose a computer is very intelligent in such a way that it can sort of mimic a human being in all aspects, then would you say that it is a conscious being or not? So this is a very hard problem in neuroscience, because no, Chetan, this is and computer science also.
Chetan, this is not a very hard problem. If you see very carefully, you see, computers can become intelligent in its own way. Okay, it will become intelligent based on data. Okay, based on, neural systems, okay, which people talk about, right? So the intelligence of a computer system or any device for that matter, it is intelligent based on data, okay, based on something. But the intelligence or consciousness which yogic science talks about, okay, it is not based on something, okay, it is something fundamental, okay, it has not been produced by something else, anything else, right? So for example, your computer may be intelligent, okay, based on data, based on algorithms, etc., etc., okay, yes. but it cannot have the freedom to select, it cannot have the freedom to feel, it cannot have the freedom, okay, in many aspects. So this freedom element is missing, okay, in these kind of systems, okay. So this intelligence of computers or any other device, okay, it is very, very static. It is mechanical intelligence, okay. So mechanical intelligence is with computers, okay. But our own intelligence, okay, the intelligence which I am talking about, which is based on that fundamental consciousness, okay, it is quite different, okay, from that intelligence. So this is how they are different.
Sir, recently when a lot of very intelligent computer algorithms have been developed, what people have realized is that it sort of seems that the computer also has started thinking. So for example, if we look at the most powerful chess engine that has been built by Google, the moves that the system plays,
yes,
they seem to be very like, it seems that the system has actually thought about the system. So you in see, that David, sense even
yes in that so, yes
yeah yes go on
okay what you're saying is okay if I go by your argument, okay, then your computer will be more intelligent as compared to humans, okay, because the computer system, they will be able to follow the various complex algorithms and data and so on, and they will predict something very accurately, okay, as compared to even humans. Okay, it is fine, but computers don't know that it is doing something even. Okay, it is predicting something. Okay, it has no feeling at all. Okay, in itself, that it is even doing something. Okay, we are making it to perform. It is we, okay, who are making it to perform. Okay, so in that context, okay, it is missing something very, very significant, that it is ignorant about itself.
Yes, sir. So I understand this point. And so the point is that at this point, the kind of computers, the kind of algorithms that we can use, they can be they can be very successful in only a particular class of problems. For example, they'll be able to optimize a particular problem, or they'll be able to do some other problem very well, but they do not know how to perform in other environments. But the idea behind the general artificial intelligence, or the broad idea of artificial intelligence system, is something that will be able to actually think like an actual human. So that's the way people sort of think that a general purpose artificial intelligence will be able to evolve.
However complex it becomes, but it will always be dependent upon the data and algorithms. Okay, you cannot discredit this data and algorithm, okay, with computers. Okay, but consciousness is not like that. Okay, consciousness does not need anything. Okay, it does not need any data or algorithms.
Yes, sir. But in a sense, even humans are human intelligence has been we also rely on some kind of algorithms and data to function. For example, the DNA that we have, it is actually a kind of a coding mechanism. So so the DNA is not like humans have this DNA that has been evolved over time from the first kind of organisms that were present on Earth, and it is this DNA which is sort of the code that we have. So even we have been we also start with some kind of an algorithm to work, and then the data that we see from around the environment and the social environment around us, this is what also leads to the intelligence in humans.
Yes, you're right.
So that's why I sort of think that a very intelligent system or a very complex system might probably have this emergent behavior of consciousness. But again, this seems to not relate to the idea of consciousness in the yogic sense that you were describing, because
you're right. Okay, you're right. We also need data. We also need algorithm. Okay, in order to think, in order to perform, okay, in order to do anything in our life. Okay, we also need data. We also need some algorithms. Okay, but with humans or with the real intelligence or with consciousness. Okay, the thing is, before we have, okay, we are. Before I have, okay, I have the sense of me. Okay, it is missing in the machines. Okay, machine can never have this sense of I, this sense of me. Okay, this is the first flash of consciousness. The sense of me, it is missing in the machines. Machine can be as intelligent as human beings, even more intelligent as human beings, as compared to human beings, in terms of data, in terms of algorithm, in terms of network of algorithms and so on. Okay, it can be much more complex as compared to human beings. Okay, but the consciousness is not there. I'm talking about consciousness. Consciousness is something else, right? Consciousness is the sense of the, you can say, the actual me. Okay, the sense of I, okay, it is missing, okay, in the machines. And this is the main difference, okay, between the consciousness and intelligence. Okay, intelligence, the machine intelligence, the machine intelligence depend upon data and complexity of algorithms. They can think like human beings. There is no problem in that. Okay. But consciousness is missing. Consciousness is something else.
Yes, sir. But again, to as a counterpoint, if you look at very primitive organisms, for example, a bacterium or a virus, say, they also, like, they can function on their own. They can do a lot of things that we associate with living objects. But again, it's difficult to say whether this bacterium has a sense of itself. So can it like recognize yes. what it is or something like yes. that? So can we say that a bacterium is conscious or not? Because it's sort of like we can sort of trace back our evolutionary history and we can realize that we are some in some sense related to a bacterium only by thousands of years of evolution.
Yes, it may be undetectable. Okay, you cannot detect the whether they have got this sense of I or not. But each and every, not only atom, subatomic particles, everything in the universe, okay, it is permeated with this sense of I, according to yogic science. It is permeated with consciousness. Consciousness is everywhere, okay, because it is beyond time, beyond space. It does not know any space or time, okay, and it is there with every kind of organism, okay, however simpler the organism is, however complex it is, okay, it is there, okay, maybe it is more complex, okay, maybe, you know, amoeba or some other simpler organism, they may have very, very primitive sense of eye, but it is there. It is not detectable, that is different thing, okay, but it is there.
Okay, sir.
Right,
I mean, this is the yogic sense thing, so I am yes. not aware of this idea.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, so enough for today, Chetan. Okay, we have talked a lot about consciousness and how consciousness plays a role, not only in yogic science, okay, but also in quantum mechanics to some extent, okay, although it is not very defined, not very concrete, okay, but I think in future it will play a very, very significant role, okay, in proposing that consciousness is very, very fundamental, okay, in order to define life, define universe, etc., etc. Okay,
okay,
okay, very nice talking to you, Chetan.
Yes, sir. Same. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, see you in the next episode. Thank you,
sir.